is fixed to send out a search warrant for you, Brother Jeremy.
Hallelujah. Amen. Glad you made it. We just want to, amen, let God have His way here this morning. It don't matter what the need may be in our lives, what the situation may be today. I serve a God that is able today to meet every need, every situation. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I feel His presence here already this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Why don't we just worship the Lord? Sister Seymour, if you have a chorus or something in your heart this morning, why don't we start the service? Amen. Amen. With some songs of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Yesterday came with your arrival.
He became that supreme sacrifice there on the cross. Amen. Shed his blood that he could cover our sins once and for all. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm thankful. I'm thankful. Amen. It was an important part of God's plan. But I'm thankful that that's not where it stopped. Hallelujah. Amen. They put him in a tomb. Hallelujah. But after 3 days, he arose. Hallelujah. He's alive forevermore. Hallelujah. And I'm thankful because he lives. Amen. I can face tomorrow. Hallelujah. Because he lives. Amen. I can have life and have it more abundantly. Hallelujah. Amen. Aren't you thankful this morning? Amen. For what? Amen. He has done for us. Hallelujah. I'm blessed this morning. I'm blessed this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. We sang that chorus around here when I think of the goodness. Amen. And all that he has done for me, my soul cries out. Hallelujah. Amen. But when I think of his grace, my soul cries hallelujah. When I think of his mercy, my soul cries hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The highest praise. Can we give him the highest praise this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We sang that song sometimes. I'm on my way to heaven, and my journey gets sweeter every day. Hallelujah. I'm walking with Jesus. I'm talking with Jesus all along the way. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the way it ought to be, church. Amen. This old world brings us problems and troubles and trials. Amen. But our walk with Jesus, amen, ought to be getting sweeter every day. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful. Amen for him this morning. Amen. Come on, Sister Felicia, lead us in. Amen. Some worship songs today. Whatever you have on your heart today. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord, church. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, okay.
stay on the firing line. There's no place for retreat. Amen. Living for God. Hallelujah. Amen. And it's that old song says it's not a recreation room. Amen. It's a fight. That's right. Amen. It's not a game. It's just, amen. We got to be serious about this. And just so thankful. Amen. I know who our captain is today. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. He leads us. He guides us today. Hallelujah. Sister Amanda. Amen. Amen. Say, play something this morning. Amen. Come and let's receive our tithes this morning. Our tithes. And then we'll receive our offering. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
This week.
Okay. Amen. Let's, Sister Felicia, let's dismiss. Amen. Amen. Our class this morning, we're going to see more coming. Amen. Hallelujah. You may have something else you want to do. You feel this morning. That's all right. Hallelujah. Amen. Whatever the Lord has. Hallelujah. Everybody say, Lord bless, Brother Seymour.
Lord, I thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, I thank everyone for being here this morning. Praise God. I was looking at Sister Christina fixed us up the church webpage, and she done a fantastic job on it.
All right.
We was about to try to pay somebody to do it. She said, I can do that. So I've done my own, done it for other teachers at school. She done a really great job on it. I don't know if any of you got to look at it yet.
No, I ain't.
She listed you in here with the ministers.
Oh, okay.
Hallelujah. Put that picture of you and Kevin and Jeremy together and you all got blue shirts on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. But I really appreciate that, Sister Christina.
The Blues Brothers.
And the Blues Brothers. Hallelujah. I like to sing that little song, Gone at Last. The lame man said, I'm God, I'm persuaded to believe there's not a person in this building that God hasn't done something for. Praise God. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you, Jesus. He'll sing that song. So he touched my body. He touched my mind. Hallelujah. Someone told me you still ain't right. Well, that's heredity. That was. I was born that way. Hallelujah. What do you know, singing? God is just good to us. Hallelujah.
Yes,
you know, I see some people that just seem like they can't even enjoy life. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Hallelujah. God created this world for us to enjoy.
Yeah. I believe that, brother. Yes, sir.
For his enjoyment, our enjoyment. You know, I see pictures, just kind of rambling on a little bit, but I see pictures some of these telescopes have taken, some of the scenery out in outer space. God created all this stuff for his pleasure.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Sometimes, you know, the things that aren't even on this world that we can see that are so beautiful that God's made. Hallelujah. He's just a great God. What he can do is beyond my imagination, and I'm not talking about that subject this morning. This morning, I'm just going to kind of preach on the subject of just thinking. Just thinking. Sometimes we got to think things out. Sometimes we've got to think about things and examine ourselves. You know, a lot of people don't think right. I was talking to Guthrie this morning about, you know, about someone that comes to church. You know, they're not all there. God can open their mind to understanding.
Yes, he can.
You know, to where they can at least get to the point where they can understand the plan of salvation, what they need to do to live for God. Hallelujah. We pray that God will help these people. Hallelujah. I want to see everybody saved. I've seen people that were, you know, that got a little bit of mental retardation and different things like that that's you know, wrong with them, but they were in a good family that's got in church and got the Holy Ghost and baptized in Jesus' name, and that might be all they understand up to that point, but you know, who much is given, much is required.
Yes. Yes.
And you know, someone that doesn't really have that much to understand, they obey the word of God like it needs to be obeyed. Hallelujah. And God honors that. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
But, you know, I want to read some verses in the Bible today, and let's compare ourselves to these verses. You know, the Bible tells us not to judge ourselves among ourselves. People that do that aren't wise, but when you line yourself up to the Word of God and examine, rightly dividing the Word. So I'm going to 2 Peter chapter 1 this morning. Hallelujah. Just thinking. Maybe sometimes I do too much of that. Maybe sometimes I don't do enough. I was teasing around my wife one time when we first got married. I told her, you don't get paid to think. She looked at me and said, well, it pays to think. Okay, I got that one. Praise God. 2 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 5. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to your virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you can be seated right there. I'm going to read on a little bit more. But there's a list of things here in the Word of God. And each thing ties into something else, and it's a growing process. You know, we don't just become completely mature, perfect Christians overnight. Matter of fact, you know, as far as being perfect, I don't think we ever attain to that. But in God's eyes, as long as we're obeying His Word and growing, He considers us perfected. And really, when we read scriptures that talk about being perfect, it's talking about being spiritually mature. It's not talking about perfect like we understand perfect, but you know, you start out as a babe in Christ, and there's a lot of things you don't understand. You know, I'm sure any of you that's been in church for a while, and you think back to when you first got in church, and all the questions you used to ask, and you know, the things you've understood up to now, you know, you're gaining spiritual maturity or spiritual perfection. We're going along those lines. But he goes on in verse 9. He says, but he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off. We got to be able to see where we're going. And hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. We're not encouraged to look back. Hallelujah. Verse 10 says, wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall. I know a lot of people refer to that calling and election, sure, as the ministry, but we're all called. We're all called to be saints. Many are called, but few are chosen. And I'm glad for the call, and I'm glad for the choice. And a lot of times the choice is yours, as much as God. The choice is yours because you choose to be obedient. The choice is God's because you were obedient and faithful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give heed. Hallelujah. Give diligence to make this calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. I remember when I first got in church, you know, I'm reading through some of these lists like this. You see in the Bible, fruits of the Spirit, gifts of the Spirit. Hallelujah. So many things that if we will work and strive to develop these things in our life, hallelujah, they will cause us that we'll never fall. I don't understand how some people seem like been in church for years and years and all of a sudden just fall off the wayside. Hallelujah. Makes me wonder if they were ever really established in what they believe or in the truth. Verse 11 says, for so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, if we keep these things in our lives. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, hallelujah, though ye know them, and be established in the present truth. It's a good thing for a minister to repeat himself sometimes. Preach the same thing over and over. It's needful for us to get these things in our mind. Hallelujah. Verse 13 says, yea, I think it meet, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance. Hallelujah. You know, a lot of times we see someone that's maybe drifting. And someone says, you know, I feel the Lord leading me just to call them and remind them of some of the things God's done for them. Remind them of some of the, you know, vows that you made to God or promises that you made to God. Hallelujah. And stir up their mind by way of remembrance. You know, the devil, he's constantly bombarding somebody, trying to get them in a state of depression. And that's why fellowship and the word of our testimony is so important. Because if we keep bombarding each other with the great things that God's done for us, it's hard for the devil to combat that. So I'm going to Proverbs chapter 23, hallelujah, and verse 7, this is a scripture that's misinterpreted a lot of times, but then again, it's also true to an extent, the way people misinterpret it. It's talking about Proverbs 23 and verse 7, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, saith he, to thee, but his heart is not with thee. You know, people always quote that and say, well, the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Well, that's not exactly what this verse of scripture is saying. It's talking about the individual that's bad company that someone is hanging around with. And he may seem like somebody good. He may, you know, here, eat, drink, you know, like he's got your best interest in mind, but you don't know what's going on in his heart. I never have understood how people can just, you know, outwardly seem like they're being so good to somebody and actually have evil plans in mind. Hallelujah. Their heart's not with it. Their heart's not with you. Hallelujah. They got ill will towards you. But I know the way people quote that, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It is still true. That might not be what this verse of scripture is talking about. But you are what you eat. Whatever you fill your mind with, what you read, what you see, what you hear, hallelujah.
Right.
The fellowship or people you hang around with. That's why evil communications corrupts good manners.
Yeah, that's right.
Filling your mind with the wrong things, that's what you become. Hallelujah. You're around somebody and they're talking about the Word of God all the time. Well, you kind of get the impression that they're a believer. They might not have the truth, but the Apostle Paul came to a group of people in Ephesus and says, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? They were believers, but they weren't, in the full truth. They wound up getting baptized in Jesus' name and being filled with the Holy Ghost. But you can tell if that's what's on their mind all the time, that's where they're headed. That's where their heart is. Talk to somebody and they're talking about fishing. They're a fisherman. You talk to somebody and they like to talk about hunting, well, they're probably a hunter. Hallelujah. Some of these things that Brother Graves and I were talking about it the other night, this is wrong to go hunting and fishing on Sunday. And I asked Brother Cocker that one time. I said, well, brother, I can't really say that it's wrong to go fishing or hunting on Sunday. He said, but let me ask you a question. If it's right at time for you to leave, to go to church, and there's a big 14-point buck walks out, do you shoot him or you let it go? And if you do shoot him and he runs off, do you trail it? Or do you go to church? What do you do with it? So I come to the conclusion, don't put myself in that position. Lord, if you want me to have that one, you send him out there on the right day. Hallelujah. I've been hunting with Brother Blackwell on Sunday before. Different ones. I've been fishing on Sunday. It's a little easier just to kind of give up on a fishing trip, especially if you ain't doing no good. And whether you're doing good or not, it's still time to go to church. It's time to go to church. It's something God honors, the fact that you put Him first. So I don't care how good they're biting, Lord. I'm going to church. My job's not to catch fish with scales. I'm supposed to catch fish with two legs.
Come on.
Be fishers of men. That's what's important. So, won't charge you no extra for that. But how do you rate? I want us to examine ourselves. Just think this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and 12. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. Now, if you didn't think you were going along the right path, you wouldn't be here this morning. Hallelujah. But he lets us know we need to constantly be considering our ways. We need to constantly be stirring up the gift that is in us. Hallelujah. It's important for us to examine ourselves and examine ourselves right. So many people examine themselves and it's with the purpose of justifying the way they're already doing. But Lord, speak to me. Hallelujah. Sometimes we don't want to hear God say, I think you caught up a little bit too much in pride in yourself. But that's what we need. I'm talking to brothers and sisters. A brother come up and tell me, look, brother, you got a problem with this. You need to start working on this, The devil would like nothing better if you would. How dare he say something like that to me? But the truth of the matter is, whether I agree with them or not at the time, it's needful for me to go and study and examine. Because sometimes, God can just have a little child say something. Not even realize you're being used of God and get you to think about things. Hallelujah. God has strange ways of working with us. Too much self-confidence breeds carelessness. And I don't want to get in that situation. There's a danger of I. The word pride, middle letter is I. Well, that's the problem with pride a lot of times. We got to look out for number one. No, that's not the truth now. Be honest. The Bible tells us to prefer our brother.
Come on. Come on.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Now, we've got to look out one for another. It's not all my deal. I was talking to somebody the other day. They weren't even in church, but I was talking about, you know, what's wrong with just being fair and honest with people? You know? Just be fair and honest with people. And sincerity. You know, it's hard for us to be fair with somebody all the time and not kind of get to the place where you kind of put yourself a little bit first. You give yourself a little bit of the advantage. Hallelujah. But it really speaks volumes to somebody that's not in church when you really put them first. It does. Galatians 6:3. For if a man think himself to be something, when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. And I pray a lot of times, Lord, don't let me get to that point. Lord, you know, I don't want to preach to others and then wind up, as the Apostle Paul said, and then myself turn out to be a castaway. I want to get it right, Lord. Hallelujah. And know-it-alls. You know, there's a problem with some of these. Hallelujah. I remember one time at school, Bill Larry Warren was assistant principal of the high school there. And I come walking down the hall and Larry Warren, he said, Ray Seymour. I said, hey, man. The man that knows it all. And I said, yeah, you know what, Mr. Warren, what really kicks me off? He said, no, what's that? I said, it's all these other people out here that think they know it all that make people like me who really do look bad. He started laughing. But you better be careful. Hallelujah. You don't know it all. Like I've already said, a child can straighten you out on some things, sometimes just by the questions they ask you. Oh, hallelujah. What's it in? Galatians 6. I don't know, right? I don't even know where the verse of scripture is. Somehow I managed to leave that out of here. I know those verses. Most of you probably do too. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. That's important. Considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. You know, I've seen it in my lifetime where I've looked at other people and said, well, how can they allow themselves to get caught up in something like that? And wound up being tempted, you know, with the same thing. You know, don't ever look down on somebody else, because God will make sure you get a chance to find out just what they're going through.
Come on, brother.
I stood in prayer with a man one time that was having a real battle with the devil. And it was back when Brother Mustang was pastor of the Decaturville Church. And Brother Max Ray Hayes. And I told Brother Mustang, I want to stand in prayer with him. You know, he's talking about the battle that he's going through, and he don't know if he can make it. I got up there and prayed. I stood with him. I said, I want you to pray that the Lord will let me share what he's going through. Take off part of his burden. And man, you talk about having some trouble. God answered something.
Yeah, I have to be careful.
I really did go through some things. But you know, years later, Brother Master Ray was still in church. He said, Brother, I remember you standing in prayer with me, you know, to share my burden. And it was because of that I was able to overcome. And you're still in church, you know, which makes you feel good. Hallelujah. But I'm here to tell you, I went through some things.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It says, let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Hallelujah. And the Bible, one verse of scripture I read, I believe it was in Proverbs. It talked about if you find a man, a good man, a godly man, wear a path on up to his doorstep. Seek good counsel. Seek good teaching. Someone that understands this word. You know, I like nothing better sometimes just to go over to Brother Cockle's house. You know, and every time I went up there, if he wasn't outside working, he was sitting down in his little rocking chair reading his Bible. And you could ask Brother Cockle some questions, and he didn't mind a bit. But if you didn't want to know the truth, you better not ask him. I'll tell you point blank. Hallelujah. But that's what we need sometimes, church. 1 Corinthians 8:2. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing. yet as he ought to know. There's always something that'll tell you how it's supposed to be. And I've said this about people, you know, in church. You know, if you're going to a good church and they're telling you the truth, that's good. But I've said it again and again, even if I'm up here teaching, you better get the book out and examine it.
Yes, sir.
And make sure. Right. You know, I may not be exactly right. I could be wrong. Hallelujah. I've searched this Bible and I thought I was right on some things, and I've kept studying and all of a sudden find somewhere where it contradicts what I believe. What do you do? Well, if it contradicts what I believe, then I'm wrong. And I need to keep studying until the word comes together like a puzzle. And the answer is there. I've never found anything that it doesn't work that way. If you have a situation and you need to know something and you start studying the word, God will reveal it to you. Hallelujah. John 5:39. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. That was Jesus speaking. There's people in our churches who think they're saved, but they're full of damnable doctrine. I see people, you know, and I talk to people and say, man, you know, my pastor preaches this, but he's not right. Really? Well, why is he not right? I mean, what's the Bible say, you know? Why do you say this? You got scripture? Well, no, I never really studied it out. Well, you don't even need to open your mouth.
Come on, bro.
Hallelujah. You need to study that word. We got to be sure. Thank you, Lord. I'm telling you, it's possible to sit on that stall pew and go to hell.
Yes, sir, bro.
We better get it right. Romans 2:3. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and you do the same, basically is what he's saying, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? This is what the leaders of the Jews were doing. And Jesus told them, well, you do what they say, but don't do like they do. You know, if they're telling you by the scripture, this is what you need to do, then you need to obey the word. But when they start doing things and extorting and robbing widows and these kind of things going on, you can't do like them. Hallelujah. Don't desire to be like that. Hallelujah. You'll do as I say and not as I do. Hallelujah. One woman was talking about telling the kids, you know, not to smoke cigarettes. Smoking one right after the other. Well, you do, Mom. Well, do as I say and not as I do. That don't work. You know, you teach a lot by example.
Example, that's right, bro.
I know Kevin said to me one time, I don't even remember what the subject was, but, you know, he said, you never taught us that. You know? I said, well, you know, some things are taught by example. Had to do with finances and paying bills and things like that. So when do you ever see me cheat anybody out of what I owe? You know, I can go to Cater County Bank right now. If I buy a new car, tell them I don't want to put insurance on it. That's going to be a lot of trouble. They require you to have full coverage. They'll let me do it. Because I pay. Mm-hmm. There's been times I've had things that I bought that got tore up. And I had to keep paying on anyway. You know, they remember stuff like that. They know who to pay. I was kind of surprised one time. The first time I wanted credit when I moved to Tennessee. And I went to Cater County Bank and I talked to John Wyatt and said, you know, you may let us borrow a couple $100. That's about it. He said, you got no credit. I thought, man, what do I do? And Brother Lanny Lomax told me, he said, brother, you want credit in this county? I said, yeah. He said, you go down there to John Deere Jones, and you buy something from him on credit. And then when you go back and you say something to the banker, and then he asks if you got any credit, and you say, yeah, well, with John Jones down there at Western Auto, he'll just get on the phone and call him. And John Jones will just tell him, whether he can trust you or not. I went in there, I got something on credit, and I paid it off, and I brought my dad down in there later. We were going to get something. He said, you know, I knew Ray was a good credit risk the first time I ever met him. I said, how? He said, you asked how much the payments were. People that don't pay don't care.
Yeah.
I said, well, I guess after years of doing this kind of business, I guess you figure it out. I'll leave. But you learn by example. There's a lot of things our kids only learn from us is by our example, how we treat people. And I hate to see times they go places and something happens in a restaurant and they blow up and chew the waitress out and all this kind of stuff. We went out to eat the other day and poor little girl, she got everything mixed up. This guy, we ended up having to go up there, they got our order wrong. Said something to management about it, and I said, I'm not really worried about it. I'll eat what I got, you know, I'm not that picky. Said, but I didn't want price adjusted, you know. Wasn't nobody getting our drinks out of the table, so I said something about that, and they started getting their drinks. And we still paid a tip, still be nice. Hey, I was trying to learn stuff like that before. I used to work in a restaurant. Hallelujah. You know, I know. I walk in a place, and I see they're just crowded, and they got shorthanded and help. I'm not going to be or our waitress. You know, I've got a principle that no matter what kind of service I get, I tip anyway. And I tip like I always would even if I get good service. Well, I wouldn't do that. Well, I'll be honest. My philosophy is when I'm done, can I invite them to church? That's my whole philosophy. When I'm done dealing with this person, you know, you just chew them out because they forgot to get you a drink while you were, you know, can I invite them to church when I'm done? My soul's more important than whether or not I got a drink with my meal. Hallelujah. Well, I don't want to let people run all over me. Well, you know, that ain't nothing compared to hell. Hallelujah.
That's right, brother.
And that's our job to help keep people like that out of hell. Praise God. You know, to do as I say and not as I do won't work. Hallelujah. And authority is no free ride. You know, some people say, well, he's a preacher, he's a pastor of church, he can get away with it. No, you can't. I'm governed by the same laws that any other saint is.
That's right, brother.
You know, the qualifications of a deacon or bishop, and you read through that and say, well, that's just requirement for a preacher. No. Any requirement to be a preacher is a requirement for a good saint. Hallelujah. That's just the word of God. Romans 12 and 3. Hurry up, homie. Hallelujah. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. You know, it's the same principle. He puts his pants on in the morning just like I do. Hallelujah. We're no different. We're all people. Hallelujah. The ground is leveled at the foot of the cross. Section I'm coming to now. So who do you think you are? I'm talking about thinking about ourselves. Looking at the Word of God. How do we line up? Who do you think you are? I've heard people say that. Who do you think you are? Statement, well, you know who I am? I don't care who you are. I know who He is and He knows my name.
Come on.
He's the only one I'm trying to keep happy.
Come on.
I know I gotta keep Mama happy too.
Yeah.
You know, it pays to get along with folks. Praise God. It pays not to get your feelings hurt too bad, too easily. I know I have different people say, well, brother, you know, I hope I didn't offend you. You don't offend me. If you did, it's water under the bridge. I'm not holding grudges. I got to make it.
Come on, brother.
But will you forgive me for this? Well, I got no choice. I got to stay in practice if I want to get to heaven. I ain't holding no grudge. I ain't giving that devil no place to try to torment me and cause me to have evil feelings with a brother. Hallelujah. There's a lot of people I don't agree with on everything. Hallelujah. And I try to study the Word if I find out that someone and I don't agree. I want to make sure I got it right. What does the Bible say? 1 Corinthians 4 and 6. And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself and to Apollos, for your sakes, that ye might learn in us not to think of men above that which is written. That no one of you be puffed up for one against another. You know who I am? It don't matter. Well, I'm the superintendent of this organization. It don't matter. You're a man just like I am.
That's right, bro.
And if you got an attitude about who you are, you need to go to an altar. That's all I got to say. You can't judge others by what you see. That's a good principle. You can't judge yourselves among yourselves. The Bible tells you that's not wise. You can't even judge yourselves by the preacher. Well, brother so-and-so does this, so if he does it, and I do it, I'm all right. That's not necessarily true. The only real measure,
come on,
right there. That's the only real measure.
That's right.
I like what Brother Price said about the mount up of error. Any of you done carpentry work, you know, if you take, you're putting blocks in a wall, and it's supposed to be, you know, on 16-inch centers, you cut that block 14 and a half inches, it's supposed to fit right plain, and if all the studs you lined up right. But if you take that little 14 and a half inch block and you draw a line on it, throw that to the guy to nail up, and cut that one, and use that for a mark on the next one, and throw that to the guy to cut it up, and use, hey man, these things are too big. Ain't no way. He said, yeah, it's 15 inches long. I think I'll put it in here. Well, what happened? It's all mounted up there. Just a pencil line. That's all it is. Just the line, the thickness of a pencil.
Come on.
It'll get you way off if you're not careful.
That's right.
That's why we got to judge by the book. That's the only real measure. Go back to the original. You want to get it right? Take that tape measure out and measure it exactly every time. It may vary just a little bit whether your saw blade is on one side of the line or the other, but it'll all keep fit. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 10:7. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trust to himself that he is Christ, let him of himself think this again, that as he is Christ, even so are we Christ. We're all of the same body. So don't be like Aaron and Mary. We got to the point and said, we're prophets too. You got to be careful of people. Well, I'm a preacher too, and I don't believe that. You got to be careful of preachers too. A preacher too is a steer you wrong. Hallelujah. Right there. If it don't line up with the book, it ain't right. I don't care who it is.
Small.
Hallelujah. Moses, Aaron, and Mary, they thought, you know, God put that in their place. So Mary was leprosy. Let them both know, yeah, I talked to you in dark sayings. Yeah, you're prophets of mine, but I talked to Moses face to face. Don't you dare come against him. Something. Warring after the flesh, when really he's warring after the spirit. But Moses wasn't just going along with carnally what he felt like needed to be done. He was in the spirit with God. God was showing him what he wanted him to do. It's like the rebellion of Korah. You know, the ground opened up and swallowed all of them, and all those that were following. And then those that remained, you know, the sympathizers of Korah, I call them. Man, God, look what you've done to Korah and all these people. You just can't quit, can you? A bunch of fiery serpents come out. I don't want no fiery serpents coming out here. I tell you right now, my wife don't want any kind of serpent. This is what's made. Corinthians 10:7. Do you look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trust in himself that he is Christ, let him of himself think this again, that as he is Christ, even so are we. I'm getting back, over the same one. 1 Corinthians 14:37. If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of God. Hallelujah. You know, it kind of caught me off guard right there. But I realized after I got to church that God would still give commandments through his apostles. God still lays laws and commandments down to the day today. Book of Acts is still being written. Don't ever rebel against the man of God. Or you just might find yourself rebelling against God. I've been in situations, you know, where the man of God told me some things, and I didn't really think he was right. But I did understand one principle in the Word of God, that when a man of God tells you to do something, God's going to honor it. You know, it was just before I was going to take this church right here. Another church had called me. They actually called Brother Price and wanted my number. They wanted me to come preach for them. I said, all right. So I said, we'll preach for them. And Brother Price called me in his office. He said, Brother, you don't need to go there. You don't need to go preach for them folks. I said, well, you know, all right. He said, what they're looking for is a pastor. And I know the history of the church, and I know what's going on there. You don't really need to go to that church, and you don't need to take it as a pastor. Like a month later, I wound up in a situation where I felt like God would want me to come here and pastor this church. Brother Price told me, he said, my wife and I both prayed about it, and I feel like it's the will of God. And go ahead and do it. So take your family with you. You're going to need them to help you. I said, all right, thank you, brother. I don't want to drag people out of the church, you know, just because I don't want to. He said, no, you'll need your family with you. So we did, you know. So he wasn't just saying it because he didn't want to lose some saints. You know, and that's the first thing the devil tries to put in your mind. But it always pays to be obedient to the man of God. God will honor him. 2 Corinthians 3 and 5. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. And that's what we need to remember. The real man of God realizes he's nothing. And that's important. If you're going to call yourself a man of God, you can't think yourself to be something. Lord knows. I've got enough natural faults. I make enough natural mistakes. Hallelujah. I don't need to think I'm something. I'll tell you that for sure. Hallelujah. But God will give him exactly what he needs for the hour. And I've seen that be true again and again. God is always there. He's always there. James 4 and 5, do you think that the scripture saith in vain that the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? There's always a danger of being puffed up. It's a big trick of the devil to try to make you think you're something when you're not. Well, you know, they got credit for what I did. Who cares? The idea is to further the kingdom of God, to see souls saved.
That's
what it's all about. Who got the credit? Hallelujah. I'll say this, I really appreciate Brother Sister Guthrie coming and being with us. Brother Guthrie leading these services. Hallelujah. Brother, you do a lot better job than I do. I don't mind saying it, and I don't care if somebody else says it. Right? I like the way things done. Don't want you to get puffed up. You know, or your hat don't fit or something. But, I keep it score. I'm not worried about it saying, all I'm worried about is whether we can see this church grow.
That's right, bro.
That's
right.
What I want to see. Hallelujah. Yeah. So we find ourselves having trouble with our attitude. Think on this. Philippians 4 and 8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things.
That's right.
Let your mind dwell on good things, and God will work it all out. Hallelujah. Don't let ourselves be deceived. Don't fret about it. Pray about it. I like that song. Worry about nothing. Pray about everything. Praise God. That's just a good song. I don't want myself short. Pray about it. 1 Peter 4 and 12. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you.
A plague time.
That's life. Pray about it. My kids used to tell me something happened in school. It's not fair. Maybe they like our response. Life's not fair. Deal with it. Pray about it. God will work it out. Sometimes God's letting you go through some things just to help you get your attitude right. Hallelujah. I've seen times when my kids had conflicts with teachers. But they had problems with the teacher. He didn't like the way she was doing things. He'd get mad. She got mad. Really, I didn't have too much confidence in the teacher. I don't think she's going to make it. I told him, I said, look, son, she's in charge of that class. She's being paid to do the job the best way she needs to do it, or the best way she knows how to do it. And I'm not going to step in. Just like you can't have parents stepping in trying to tell the teacher how to do her job. You're in that classroom, line up. If you make a teacher mad, she's going to nitpick everything you do after that. That's human nature. Apologize to her. Problem is, I think there's a personality conflict. But you managed to work things out. Things worked out okay. But you know, some parents are getting mad. They want to step in. They want to get involved. Try to do this, do that. You know, that's all part of life. You're going to deal with some things in life that you don't like, feel like you're not treated fair. That's part of learning. That's an experience. You need to know how to deal with these things. You need to know how to work it out. You need to know how to pray and ask God to help you work it out. Hallelujah. Pray about it. But don't bore God with it. Hallelujah. I don't want to just bother with God with every little thing. I'll ask him about it and put it in his hands. I'll just keep coming back again. God will take care of it if you ask him to. Matthew 6 and 7. But when you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do.
That's right.
For they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. But there is truth to the song. Till the answer comes, you got to keep praying. Got to keep praying. Got to keep praying. Till the answer comes, you got to keep praying. Pray until the answer comes. Sometimes you might be on your knees for hours. Sometimes you might get right through the door. Hallelujah. Just got to keep knocking again. Hallelujah. I don't work on this repetition, but hallelujah. There are prayers, memorial prayers that build up before God, and that's what you're doing. Not vain repetition. You know, some prayers are like layaway. You keep praying about it, you keep asking God about it, and when you finally get to the point it needs to be, you go ahead and get, when you get that thing paid for, you can go ahead down there to Walmart or wherever and get it, because you paid for it. Hallelujah. Prayers like that sometimes. Sometimes there's prayer where you got to, you know, like Brother Guthrie said the other day, Jesus! That's all time you got to say.
Yeah.
Right. He answers that kind of prayer too. Hallelujah. James 1 and 7. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. I'm just keep vain repetition. You know? I used to pray the rosary beads. I would just do the rosaries and start out with Our Father. And I'd go further and say five Hail Marys. And do the Apostles' Creed. And do five Hail Marys. Come on around and get another one and say Our Father. And five more Hail Marys. And then another Our Father. And go all the way around that big rosary and pray that. And then you pray the act of contrition. And you go back down the beads. Supposed to answer your prayer. That's not what God's looking for.
No.
You know? And we do the same thing sometimes. Well, I spent an hour in prayer. Well, you spent an hour on your knees looking at the clock, but how much You don't want to pray in vain. I've been guilty of this stuff. You know what I'm saying? I'll be on my point finger, nobody. But you're not going to receive anything from God that way. A relationship with God is what brings results. Verse 8 of James 1 says, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Vain repetition. This person's double-minded. Luke 11 and 9. And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. It's a double reminder, because if you write those words down, the first letter of ask is A, first letter of seek is S, and the first letter of knock is a K. So it says it all over again. Ask, seek, knock. Ask. He wants you to ask. Hallelujah. And my conclusion. Matthew 24:44. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man comes. The whole idea, church, is to be ready. Constantly examining ourselves. I want to make it. I don't want to let something, you know, that I haven't noticed or neglected cause me to miss out with God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand. Hallelujah. Lord's goodness.
Thank you.
So, our Sunday school report. You don't want to stay in Egypt, that's what you learn. It's time to get out of there. Egypt was once my home, and I was a slave. But I'm glad God called me out of there. Praise God. So is there any announcements?
Danielle just texted me. She wanted us to pray for Spencer. She thinks he's got pink eye in both eyes.
Black will be with us this evening. He'll be preaching for us. Last minute deal. Called him yesterday and asked him on my bag not to give him much notice. I don't think Brother Black will have any trouble coming up.
You'll have one.
So, come again tonight, expect it. Brother Black will. And I'll tell this to y'all. He asked me, and he probably wants everyone up there. He wants to be used. Preferably in just a few. So, I've been praying for him. Praying for him. Lord, you know, Lord, do it. If you have a desire to do it, I've never seen the black will be the time to get fucked up. Let's be praying for the service tonight and come expecting.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
So let's pray. We'll be dismissed in Jesus' name. Glory to you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.